Follow that cable car.
Thank you, Sergeant.
I guess that winds up the Levinson case.
Put your seat back a little ways. It's a lot better.
If I were you, Commissioner, I'd spend the evening in a hot tub.
A good idea if I can talk six people into climbing in with me. Gotta make a séance.
You're going to a séance tonight, sir?
Afraid so.
Well, don't be afraid. I've been. They're a little spooky, sure, but it's worth it considering the information you pick up.
Information you pick up?
Yeah. What's the name of your seer, sir?
Now, my seer is a seer of a friend. A very dear friend has just been told her husband is coming back from the dead.
From the dead? That's quite a trick.
Yeah. That's why I want to be there.
We are here among the dead, waiting for you who are out there in the great beyond to communicate with us. We ask that you make your presence known. Ours is a distinguished group here tonight. Commissioner of Police Stuart McMillan and his lovely wife. Magician Harry Hastings, known professionally as the Great Mandini, who last week here at this table heard the spirit of Arthur Kendall speak to us. The gracious and beautiful Nora Dane. And most important of all, Arthur asked that his beloved wife Evie be here with us, and she is. Evie Kendall is here and waiting, accompanied by her doctor, Eli Spake. Join hands, please. Well,
old Gabriel's apparently putting in an appearance tonight. Now, that's her best trick. From here on, it's usually downhill.
I feel the presence of Arthur Kendall. Arthur is trying to get through. Arthur, we know you are here. We ask you to join us in our circle of love. Oh.
Evie. Evie! Evie! Oh, Evie. Oh, Evie. Why? Why did you kill me? Why did you murder me?
Listen to me. Listen to me, Evie. It's all right. Now, come on, I'll take you home.
Sally! Sally, come with me, please!
Are you coming, Nora?
No, no, I'd just be in the way, but please tell her again how awful I feel. God, to lose your husband's bad enough, but to have him called from the dead. I should know. Mine called from Hong Kong last night. To tell me that the alimony would be late again.
Oh, well, at least it was a friendly call. Nora, will you tell Mac that I went with Evie?
Madam Zara. Would you mind telling me how this trick was done?
I most certainly would mind. Do you think I shake like this after a trick? A cheap trick. It's true. I do sometimes resort to tricks. I can command this trumpet to float in midair. But, Commissioner, what you have just seen was a true visitation.
Sally wanted you to know she went with Evie.
Okay, thanks, Nora.
Admit, I wonder why I was chosen myself. Why he picked me for one of the great psychic experiences. Obviously, there is a purity about me that even I hadn't recognized. But I was ready. And what you saw was a true miracle from the grave, an anguished soul pointing an accusing finger at the person who murdered him. I think I'm going to give up the trumpet.
Yes, ma'am. Harry.
I don't know, Mac. I don't know how she did it. I've checked every wall and every baseboard, and I don't know. I know she's a first-class fraud, but last week I heard him, and tonight I saw him.
How dare you, Harry Hastings. I have seen many of your tricks, but I have always remained polite. And now tonight, you see a true visitation, and you can't even be gracious about it. You are riddled with jealousy. But I take that as a supreme compliment.
Then I trust you'll take it as a supreme compliment if I call the Bunko Squad to go over this room.
I am deeply honored. I didn't kill him. I didn't kill him.
Of course you didn't, Evie. We all know that.
And why did he say it? Why?
We don't know that it was Arthur.
Mac doesn't believe in ghosts. I don't either.
Look, she really should be resting now.
No.
Evie, you're going to take a sedative. You've got to rest.
No, not yet. I want to tell Mac and Sally everything.
That can wait till tomorrow.
No, now. Mac, you and Sally remember this little item. A memento of my suicide attempt 2 years ago.
I don't think that now is the time to discuss it. Eli's right. Let's wait till tomorrow. Good night's sleep.
I'm not discussing suicide. I'm talking about this razor. After I tried to use it, Arthur hid it. I never knew where.
That's right. Then, maybe a month ago.
I'm telling this, Eli. A month ago today, I found it lying open on my dressing room table. And only a week later, I opened a closet door and found a suit of Arthur's clothes hanging there, caked with blood.
Darling, must you?
Yes, I must.
And yesterday, an oil portrait of Arthur that had been put away in storage. Come with me, please. It suddenly reappeared. There on the wall. When the maid saw it, she quit. I stood here staring up at it and remembered the day that I tried to quit. That was the worst fight that Arthur and I ever had. The very next night, he called from our cabin in the mountains and asked me to join him there. But I didn't. No, I didn't. I wasn't the one that fired that gun. I never went.
Evie, you were proven innocent.
Yes. Yes, you did that for me.
No, a jury did.
Evie, you've been through more than enough for one night. Now, please, take a sedative now.
No. No.
Evie, what is it?
Smells like tobacco smoke.
My last birthday present to him. Why is this happening? Why?
That's why we're here, Evie. Find out why.
And Mac will, Evie.
It's Arthur. It's Arthur. Find him, please. He's got to be here. He is here. I can feel his presence. He's in this room right now. Show yourself, Arthur. Show yourself. Arthur.
Give me the willies. My grandmother used to live in a haunted house. I was a little girl at the time.
Your grandmother used to live in a haunted house?
Mm-hmm. It was all she could afford.
Did you ever see any ghosts?
Oh, sure, I saw them. But I never heard one talk like you two did last night. Arthur Kendall talked, wow.
He talked.
Somebody talked.
But what did he sound like with his head shot off?
She's got a point there, you know that?
I mean, that poor man up there in the mountains trying to get a little rest. He opens the door and there stands somebody with a shotgun. What do I mean, somebody? If he said his wife killed him, she did. And that's why his poor ghost is earthbound. No one will believe him.
Mildred, Evie did not kill him.
Oh, I know she's one of your closest friends, Mrs. McMillan. But if Arthur said she did it, she did it. Oh, would you like a little coffee?
Thank you.
Oh. I better get some fresh.
Mac, what if Evie starts thinking like Mildred does? She'll become convinced that she did kill him, and it'll drive her insane. You can't let that happen, Mac. She's counting on you.
I know. The problem is trying to figure out what our friend the ghost is counting on.
We covered every square inch of that séance room, sir. Nothing. Marnie Ellsworth couldn't have been more cooperative.
She's been waiting all her life to be investigated by a bunco squad.
Yeah, well, I also had them check into her past. Always a lot of hocus pocus, but always within the law.
What's that odor?
Oh, oil of cloves, sir. I got a molar that's killing me. Nice smell, huh?
Very nice. There it is.
boy. When Harry Hastings says a man's home is his castle, he isn't kidding. Hello in there. Well, now what do?
We say open sesame.
You see?
Wet.
Sergeant Enright, this is the great Mandini.
Sergeant? Well, we're getting the hands in shape, putting together our new show.
Didn't know you gave them anymore, Harry.
Well, except on special occasions, I don't. Like the circus, the day of magic, the day of the magician is almost over. Night of the wizard, twilight of the gods, you might say. However, I'm booked into one last grand tour. We're opening tonight at the Club Castile. Toothache, Sergeant?
No, I'm just a little on edge.
Better?
It's gone.
Temporary relief. In a few hours, it'll wear off, so I advise you to check with your dentist. Otherwise, I'm in trouble with the ADA. Here, Sergeant, let me show you another. Take a card.
Harry, Enright and I are here to talk about last night.
Mac, what if I were to tell you... What if I were to tell you that I didn't think it was a trick?
Oh, come on, Harry. You don't believe in ghosts any more than I do. You've exposed every case we ever handed you. He's caught more frauds than any man I know. Given expert testimony in court, time and time again. All negative, Harry. No such thing as ghosts. Don't tell me now, after all this, that you're suddenly going to start believing in them.
I know what I saw. Nobody could be more shaken than I.
You can't honestly believe that Arthur Kendall came back from the dead and talked to us.
Mac, please try to understand what all this means to me. I mean, the search to find the supernatural has been the quest of every great magician, and for obvious reason. With all our illusions, tricks, devices, we still secretly want to believe that such a thing does exist, called the true magic, that extra step into the unknown. And last night, after all these years, I witnessed it. I heard it. I saw it. My body, I felt cold, clammy, because I knew that here it is, the dead can return. And no wizard of legerdemain, myself included, could ever create an illusion so real as the ghost of Arthur Kendall.
The medium sat here, Nora Dane here, and the magician here. Evie Kendall here, and Dr. Spake here. Sally and I sat over here. Arthur Kendall appeared about here from my sightline.
We checked, sir, and there was no evidence of projection equipment or mirrors to create the image.
That means the image was created by the presence of a real person.
In the flesh, sir.
These drapes concealed the door through which he obviously came.
But, sir, that door was locked.
It was locked when I tried. It doesn't mean it was locked when he tried.
Well, Commissioner, conducting your own private seance, I see.
No, just consulting the future, Chapman. Trying to see if the district attorney is ever going to win a case.
That's good, Mac. Very good. Now look into the past and see if you should have won the case of E.V. Kendall.
Why? You thinking of putting a ghost up on the witness stand?
I'm dreaming about it. Especially about the part where he testifies to the fact that she killed him.
What's your angle?
Justice isn't an angle, Commissioner.
Why don't you turn that into a bumper sticker? You know that Evie Kendall was acquitted of that murder. And even if she walked into this room right now and confessed, the laws of double jeopardy would prevent you or anyone else from taking legal recourse. So, what's your angle?
Well, let's see. She testified that she took sleeping pills that night. But did she? She could have driven up to that mountain cabin, killed him, and who would have known? If I can prove she lied about that alibi, we've got her on perjury 1 to 14 years.
Look, Chapman. Evie Kendall is in a very delicate and dangerous state of mind. This is not the time to force her to relive that case with a lot of hard questions.
You and your wife are just too close to her, Max. She could have done it, you know, and a thing like murder shouldn't be allowed to just lie there.
No, it shouldn't, and it should have been solved by now.
It could have been solved by now. Tell me, Mac, what bothers you more? That you saw a ghost? Or that you let a murderess get off scot-free?
Feeling you were being used, Sally?
Mm-hmm.
It's the way I feel. Hello?
Commissioner, I found a report that a lawyer now dead was called upon to draw up a contract of some kind between Arthur Kendall and Harry Hastings.
What kind of a contract?
Well, the deal was never made, sir, so we don't know.
But Harry Hastings does.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Pandora's box. Contrary to legend, Pandora never opened the box, never discovered the contents.
Its hideous creatures were never set loose over the countryside. It was taboo, forbidden.
And for that reason, in 1704, this lock was placed on it. Through all the long years and the many centuries since then, Pandora's box has remained...
Oh, Nora, I wish Joe would come back.
Shut.
They're divorced. My little romantic, you do know what that means.
I don't want to discuss it.
Okay.
Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, you are in for a rare and eerie experience. Tonight, this night... For the first time in history, Pandora's box is to be opened.
Scare you?
Great looking. I think Pandora's gonna jump out.
Blind in your back. You're the one who ordered ringside.
I love it.
Thank you.
Jack, he's terrifying those women. I'm not easily frightened, but if I were, well, it'd be enough to drive you batty. You do think it's a little scary, don't you, Mac?
Do you suppose that was the deal?
What?
The deal between Arthur and Harry. To drive Evie out of her mind.
Horrible.
Come in.
Great show, old great Mandini.
Absolutely terrifying. You want to see my goosebumps?
Sally, no.
I could show you a few of my own.
You mean you scare yourself?
Only on opening night.
That Pandora's Box illusion's quite a horror show, Harry.
I hope so.
You always end your act with a number that leaves them screaming?
That's my trade, Mac. It's part of it anyway.
It could scare the wits out of anybody.
I didn't make that deal with Arthur Kendall, Mac. In fact, when he asked me to drop by that afternoon, I assumed that he and Evie were both there, and it was just for a visit. I quickly discovered that he was alone, and...
It's a surprise party, Harry. Evie's birthday. It'll be quite a group, 20, 30 people. Now, just before Evie comes down the stairs, I'm gonna make sure there's a power failure.
Power failure? You're suggesting she come downstairs in the dark?
Well, why not? That's the idea, surprise. But what a surprise. Just before the lights go up, you unleash those squiggly creatures from Pandora's box.
Arthur, are you aware that she's never seen that trick before?
She's never even heard of it. That's what's so great. She won't know what's happening.
Women have been known to faint when I perform that illusion, Arthur. You know that. You know it.
Evie won't faint. Heaven forbid.
No, Arthur. The answer is a definite no.
What do you mean, no? Harry, I'm not asking you to do me a favor. I'm engaging your professional services, standard contract. In fact, now that you mention it...
I didn't mention it.
I'm having one drawn up. Name your price. The lawyer will fill it in.
Good day to you, Arthur.
You're not leaving just yet. What are you trying to pull?
What are you trying to pull, Kendall?
Harry Hastings. The great Mandini. Magician extraordinaire, is that it? All right, I'll lay a bundle on you for just one performance.
Including health and welfare, including that...
Yes, Harry. You may need health and welfare sooner than you think. You know, magicians aren't exactly in demand these days. Or do you plan to stand on local street corners and pull rabbits from hats in hopes that people will throw pennies at you?
I should have hit him. I wanted to, but I didn't. I simply got out of there.
Mac, that's the last time I talked to Arthur Kendall.
Why would he want to scare her like that?
Why? To drive her back to an asylum, of course.
For a money seller, that's why he married her.
That's also why he wanted to get rid of her. Imagine thinking about money when you're face to face with a creature as lovely and as fragile as Evie Kendall. She is quite simply the most exquisitely beautiful woman in the world.
Mac, he's in love with Evie. Isn't that nice?
I hope so.
Remember that movie with Charles Boyer?
Yeah, and Ingrid Bergman.
Come back, Mac.
Yeah, well, that's exactly what Arthur was trying to do. Gaslight her.
And what someone's still trying to do. But who now?
Well, now, oh, daughter of the great criminologist, who's got the most to gain?
I can't think of anybody but Arthur.
Exactly.
But he's dead.
You sure?
Well, how could he be alive? He couldn't. How?
I'm going to exhume Arthur's body.
Oh, Mac.
And I'll have to get Evie's permission.
Suppose we're wrong.
Don't think I haven't thought of that.
I feel fine. But you obviously have some bad news for me. What is it, Mac?
Not bad news. No, I have a proposal I'd like to make to you, but I don't want it to upset you.
I'm fine, really. Propose.
Evie, has it ever occurred to you that Arthur might still be alive?
Mac, how can you even say that?
Because no one can prove his appearance at the séance was a trick, and I refuse at this late stage of my life to start believing in ghosts.
Mac, do you really think he's alive?
We don't know, of course, Evie.
We have to be sure. There's only one way.
How do you do that?
Exhume the body, and I need your permission.
Now, you're taking a terrible risk subjecting her to this.
Eli, please. Mac, if you feel it's the right thing to do, then do it.
Commissioner, I'm sure you're aware that you're dealing with a woman who has a past history of emotional disturbance. Now, during the trial, she transferred her dependence to you, and that's all right. But ideally, since the trial, as her psychiatrist, I should have come to bear some of that responsibility. Well, I didn't. It remains with you. You're the one she counts on. And if you fail her, she's gone. Only this time, there won't be any recovery. Now, do I make myself clear?
Yes, you do, Dr. Spake, but there's one thing you don't understand. Sally and I love Evie, too. Where's Sykes?
He went to get the coroner's report.
Did he say anything?
Only that he wanted to tell you himself, though he was smiling.
Commissioner, I've got great news
for you. Great, let's hear it. Mm-hmm.
Well, first of all, because of the intervening year, it was impossible to get any fingerprints. Did you get a haircut?
Yeah. Come on, Sykes.
Thought so. Well, then we checked for bone fractures. And there was no discrepancy between the corpse and Arthur Kendall's medical record.
What did you find out?
The dental plates. It so happens that the man who did those plates is a friend of mine. As a matter of fact, he did this bridge. Take a look at that work, will you?
Oh, yeah, it's lovely.
Is that beautiful?
Oh, lovely.
Well, he's a fine man. He's one of the best in profession. And I talked to him personally.
Sykes, what exactly did he tell you?
A perfect match. No question about it.
About what?
That the corpse is Arthur Kendall.
He's dead?
You bet he's dead.
Thank you, Sykes.
Well, I must say he didn't seem too pleased.
Sykes, he didn't want the body to be Arthur Kendall.
He didn't? Well, nobody told me.
Well, what would you have done about it if they had?
Well, I could have been a little less cheerful.
Arthur's dead.
Oh, then we're back where we started, aren't we? Oh, Mac. You don't know how I was hoping this would all finally be at an end. That we'd know who it was. I was counting on it.
I was counting on it too, Evie. I was convinced. Otherwise, I wouldn't put you through all this.
Well, there's nothing to do but go home again, is there?
I'll take you home, Evie. Mac, why don't you pick me up there?
Dr. Spake, please. Commissioner McMillan calling. Hello, Eli? Mac. Yes, we've just had the report. The body is Arthur Kendall's. No, I've already told her. So I'm calling you. Sally's taking her home now, and I think it's a good idea if you were there when they arrived. All right, we can talk about it later.
Excuse me, sir.
Boy, if I was ever set up for one, this is it.
Set up for it?
A first-class criminal mind, too. He's been ahead of me every step of the way. He knew that séance would terrify Evie, but not enough to drive her insane. Just enough to make her lean on me a little bit more. He knew I'd exhume the body, which would give her new hope, knowing full well the body was Arthur's. And he knew what that would do to her. Using me to push her right on the edge of madness. Well, if he knows me that well, then I must know him. Well, who is it?
Coat and purse, right there. If Evie were to come downstairs and see her best friend screaming like a banshee, then it would really drive her mad. What am I talking to? I'm talking to the wind.
Sally!
You're dead! You're dead!
Thank you.
are to blame for this.
You may have destroyed her tonight.
Primitive fear of the unknown. It's remarkable what it can do to you.
Who could it be?
Fear of the dark.
Motive, motive, motive.
Mildred says you disturbed his grave. She says they don't like that. Mildred also
Sally,
says...
Sally, stop thinking about that now. Really.
Right. I'm not going to think about it.
Mildred.
Oh, it's you, Commissioner.
Sorry, Mildred. I thought I heard it. The roast beef was very good tonight, wasn't it?
Well, who could eat with all those poltergeists roaming around? Poltergeists. Those are the destructive ones, you know. Want one?
No. Enough.
Well, I ask. Good night.
It was Mildred getting ice cubes.
I thought it was Mildred. It was just that I was thinking that. As a little girl, I was afraid of the dark. So sometimes my mother left the light on for me.
You want one on now?
Not as long as you're here.
This is a Richmond lock. It's identical to the one found on the side door of the medium's seance room. To open the door, you turn the lock to the right. You close the door, it locks again. Would you open the door, please? Open it. Yeah, thank you.
Then it was locked from the outside.
That's right.
Whoever impersonated Arthur Kendall at the seance had to have an accomplice on the inside.
That's right.
Anything else?
Yes. We vacuumed the room thoroughly. The lab has analyzed the contents.
And?
Well, we found the usual dust, flakes of phosphorescent paint, and these. Pine needles, caked with mud, could have been tracked in the bottom of somebody's shoes. It's a silver-tipped Pacific fir, endemic to high altitudes, found in mountains all through this region.
There's a grove of them up at Kendall's Mountain Cabin. All right, let's take a run up there. Thank you, Sykes.
Thank you.
Since you're so busy, Sergeant, you know I don't mind driving.
No, I can handle it, Commissioner. I can handle it.
You should have gotten the number of that dentist that Sykes was recommending so highly.
Well, as a matter of fact, sir, I did.
Oh, good. When's your appointment?
Huh? Oh, it's right about now.
You sure you don't want me to drive?
No, I'm fine, sir. I'm fine. Commissioner, I wish you'd remember that I'm the one with the gun.
Thank you, Sergeant. I'll try to keep that in mind.
Who do you think it was, sir?
I don't know. Let's go see what he didn't want us to see.
Hello?
Evie? Oh, Evie. This is Arthur. Evie, I must see you. I must see you, Evie.
Where are you?
At the old beach house. Oh, hurry. Hurry to me, Evie.
Yes. Yes, I'll be there.
Enright. Arthur Kendall's tobacco. Special blend.
Well, now we know where he got the stuff to frighten Mrs. Kendall. He being whoever's impersonating Arthur Kendall.
But why? Why smoke it when no one else is around, unless you enjoy it?
Well, you know how it is, sir. You try it.
Right.
You like it.
Commissioner? Whoever it was had female company. Take a look.
That's the dress Nora Dane wore the night of the seance.
Then you think that she was the one that opened the door that night?
No, I do.
Well, then Nora's husband, Joe, must be our ghost. She just pretended that he was overseas. Actually, he was here all the time trying to gaslight Mrs. Kendall.
Why? Nora and Joe have nothing to gain if Evie's put away. Only Arthur Kendall, her husband, could get the money.
Well, maybe they made a deal with Arthur Kendall. Well, that's no good. He's dead. This thing really hurts. Who else had a motive? Yeah, that's better. You know, sir, I bet I wind up needing a bridge just like Sykes. It's expensive, too. Because you always have to have two of them made in case you lose one or one gets broken or...
Enright?
Oh, I'm sorry about the odor, sir, but it really helps.
You're a genius.
Well?
Call that dentist.
From here?
Find out if Arthur Kendall had a spare plate made.
That's it. Kendall had a spare, and he stuck it in the corpse's mouth.
And pick up Evie. I want her in protective custody. And put out an APB on Arthur Kendall.
Yes, sir. Boy, an all-points bulletin on a dead man. Wait till we hear this one. Commissioner?
Yeah?
If Arthur Kendall is alive, who's dead?
I'll get the answer to that right now.
Arthur Kendall is dead, Mac. You've got to believe me.
You're lying, Nora. Arthur Kendall is alive, and you're conspiring with him to drive Evie insane.
Oh, Mac, I'm surprised.
Come off it, Nora. School's out.
You don't know what you're saying.
Don't I?
No.
You think an investigation won't prove you and Arthur are having an affair?
Oh, all right, so we had an affair. So what?
So what? Out of that affair came the plan to get Evie's money and take off.
Oh, now you're the one.
Of course, you had to get rid of a husband, and Arthur had to get rid of a wife. It worked out just fine, didn't it?
It isn't.
Get Evie committed! Not too difficult where a man as clever as Arthur is concerned.
Mac, you're wrong.
Am I?
Mm-hmm.
Something went wrong that night at the cabin, didn't it? Your cute little trick backfired, and all of a sudden you're involved in a murder.
Mac, you're wrong. You are dead wrong.
Am I? Why don't we ask Joe? Why don't we call Joe in Hong Kong and ask him? Or maybe we'd be wasting our time because Joe's dead. That is Joe in the coffin, isn't it?
Yeah. Yes, that's Joe. Poor dumb Joe. No matter what you think, it started off without wanting anyone dead. It began when Arthur invited Joe and me up to the cabin for the weekend. Joe, he had no idea what was up. He just thought it was fun time.
Then Arthur called Evie and said he was up there.
Yes, that was the plan. When she arrived, I was to say, why, Evie, don't you remember? You phoned me and invited Joe and me to spend the weekend here. Then when she went home, Arthur was going to insist that he hadn't called her at all. He was at a motel halfway down the mountain, waiting to get the results. But it got late and Joe and I went to bed. Then in the middle of the night, there was a knock on the door and I told Joe that must be Evie.
Arthur planted his own ID on Joe's body. Wristwatch, ring, wallet, and spare dental plate.
Joe's unrecognizable. I don't know how I let Arthur talk me into this. You see, he figured that if Evie wasn't found guilty of murder, he would just destroy her as his own ghost. Clever, huh?
Yeah, clever.
A clever, clever man. And such a good actor. When I phoned him at the motel to tell him what had happened, he really made me believe that he hadn't planned it at all. Actually had me convinced that Evie really had done it. And I used to think Joe was the dumb one.
If Arthur was at the motel, he couldn't have killed Joe.
Then Evie did do it.
Evie's not here, sir. Dr. Spake talked to her on the phone, asked her not to go out tonight, but she wouldn't listen to him. She took a gun. She told him that she was going to go out to the beach house and kill Arthur Kendall. Now, I've looked everywhere for that address, sir, but I can't find it. Dr. Spake doesn't know where it is either. I can't find anybody who does.
Well, I can. You were there 3 or 4 summers ago, Sally. Now, try and remember.
I'm trying, Mac. I remember the street, and then I remember I used to turn right at a billboard. I remember the billboard because it used to say Wilson for DA, and that was that guy that you caught trying to bribe the jury.
Well, don't you remember a more current landmark?
Yes, there. Mother Boland's brown bread. Turn right there, right there.
Phone's dead.
Call for the car.
Arthur Kendall. It's Evie's.
That's correct, Enright. Yeah, the ambulance is leaving now. Yes, he's alive.
We put out an APB on Mrs. Kendall.
And Nora Dane's been booked on criminal conspiracy.
Very good.
Anything else I can do, sir?
Yeah. Get a good night's sleep.
Thank you, sir.
Feel okay?
Poor Evie. Imagine being driven to murder.
You think she shot Arthur?
You don't?
Not with that fight that went on in the house.
Of course, Evie's no match for Arthur. He must have fought with a man.
Or if we believe in the Equal Opportunity Act, a very strong woman.
Mac, come on, you're on to something.
Well, let's start with the murder of Nora's husband, Joe. Nora says she didn't do it. Evie says she didn't do it.
Who do you think's telling the truth?
Well, maybe they both are.
But if that's the case, we're out of suspects.
Well, there are plenty of suspects, but we're out of his clues.
Well, anyway, at least Arthur's alive.
At least you don't have to believe in ghosts any. Sally, I love you.
You better. What did I do? at least tell me what I said.
That's what I said.
Central, go ahead, sir.
Sergeant Enright, quickly. Sally, suppose somebody loved Evie very much and knew she was being driven insane.
And he killed Joe that night, thinking it was Arthur?
Suppose Arthur was about to kill Evie, and somebody walked in on him.
They fought, and he got Evie's gun, and he shot him.
Now, what would your average run-of-the-mill killer do in a case like that?
Kill Evie to get rid of all the witnesses.
Unless he thought she was the most beautiful, most exquisite woman in the world.
Harry Hastings.
Enright, sir.
Sergeant, get a squad and meet me at Harry Hastings immediately.
Yes, sir.
You stay here.
But Mac...
Wait in the car and wait for the police.
But I'll just stay with you so you can see I'm not frightened.
Come on.
Ah! Woo! Tell me those are not bats.
Okay, they're not bats.
Why is he doing this?
Because they're the weapons he knows the best. Come on, do you think he can make it?
Evie! My last illusion. She isn't dead. She's just resting. She'll wake up in a few minutes.
Is that the only way you could get her to come with you? Hypnosis?
Well, fortunately, Mac, it's part of my trade. You see, mesmerizing an audience helps create certain illusions, makes them quite real, quite real. You agree, don't you, Sally? Mac?
Mac, he's hypnotizing us.
Harry, forget it.
Yes, of course. You're too strong a septum.
No use, Harry. Police are on their way.
The police? I have catacombs here. I have underground passages. You'll not be able to find me. I'm going to keep her here. She's going to be with me. She'll be mine. I'm going to protect her. I'm going to protect her from all of you. See, Mac, it's so simple. I love her. I have always loved her. I tried to explain that to her, that I didn't want her to be hurt anymore. No, Mac. Don't do it.
Barry, think of Evie. Think how she'll feel when she finds out you've killed us. Evie won't love you anymore.
Oh, yes, she'll understand. She didn't trust you anymore. She trusts me now. No. I'm the one she called when she went to meet Arthur at the beach house. It was me.
Then why hypnotize her? It's because she stopped trusting you when she saw you shoot Arthur. And she'll hate you if you do this, Harry.
No.
She'll hate you forever.
No, Max,
she'll
don't
hate
say
you.
It. Don't say
hate
it.
You.
She won't hate me. She'll love me. She will love me.
How do you like my fine feathered friend?
I'd be glad you don't have to clean his cage. There. Careful.
You're gonna be all right, Evie.
Harry.
For a minute. Didn't even act like a regular ghost. Showing up at a séance and accusing somebody of murder who didn't even do it.
Arthur thought Evie had done it.
Well, how could he think that when he wasn't even dead?
Oh, Evie, that's marvelous.
And that Harry Hastings, what did he think when the ghost said Evie murdered him?
Well, what do you think? He thought he'd gotten away with it.
Well, if Arthur really had been dead, he could have used his supernatural powers.
Harry didn't think about that.
Okay, bye, Evie. Evie sends you 40 million kisses, and I'm to deliver them personally.
Oh, Mildred.
Yeah, right. Good night. Oh, you think it's safe to take the hemlock off the door?
Yes, Mildred. And the juniper, and the henbane.
Right.
Okay, Mr. Smart Guy, before all this kissing starts, give a girl a break. What was the big clue that made all the lights pop on and say, Harry Hastings?
You don't know?
I don't know.
You almost guessed it yourself.
I know. I almost guessed as it was something that you said when they put Arthur in the ambulance.
I said you don't have to believe in ghosts anymore.
Of course, Harry Hastings believed completely in the ghost of Arthur Kendall because he believed that he had killed him. Oh, I should have gotten there.
Hey. 40 million, right here.
Coming, Master.